and get started. And so today we are thinking about mission at our church. And so we're going to look at past, what's happened in the past few years. We're going to look at the present and what lies ahead for us, both this year in the future and in the future. And so before we get started, why don't we open up with a word of prayer, thanking God for this morning. Holy God, we are so grateful that you have brought us all together to think about mission, think about how we can be your hands and feet in the world. And we're thankful that you have put us in this place where we can be that for others, be that presence, be that, show your love to those who so desperately need it in our world. And so we ask that you use this time to broaden our minds and help us to see the path you are laying out for us as we think about mission this year and beyond. In your holy name, we pray. Amen. All right. So glad everyone's gathered today. The way we're going to do our adult education this morning, or the way I'm hoping it will work, is we'll have a general discussion about mission. So I'm hoping that we'll all kind of share our experiences of what mission has looked like here at the church. We'll see what our mission committee is planning for this year in terms of trips, as well as other special programming. And we'll think about what possibilities or where might God be calling us to go or to move in the future. And so this is PPC mission, the past, the present, and the future. And so I thought we'd start off with a video that comes from our National Capital Presbytery. And so this is kind of our regional presbytery group, if you will, if you're unfamiliar with National Capital Presbytery. So basically it's DC, Maryland, and Virginia. And so it's this area, so we fall within that. And so our general presbyter, John Molina Moore, is gonna talk about how crucial mission is to who we are as a church. So I think it's a good starting point to remind ourselves why mission is so important. So we're gonna begin with this and then dive into it.
Hey everyone, my name is John Molina Moore. I am the general presbyter here at National Capital Presbytery, and our presbytery's identity is wrapped up in three words: missional, pastoral, prophetic. We started this process back in 2017, where we set out a five-year plan about how we would live into those three words. So our first word is missional. What does it mean to be missional? Well, the word missional comes from the Latin word miso, which means to be sent. So a missional church, a missional congregation, is one who is outwardly facing, who is less focused about bringing people inside their church walls, but more about being out in the community and doing ministry together. Now, our next two words, pastoral and prophetic, it's helpful to understand those if we found out how it is that we actually got to those three words. So when we started this process about the mission statement, many of you sat down in a room together and you thought about different ideas and themes and images that you hope this presbytery could become and be about. And through that, things emerge like new churches, new worshiping communities, doing things like confronting racism and engaging in actual real evangelism out in the world. So through those things, we decided, well, those fit into categories of words that might be like pastoral and prophetic. So from pastoral, the idea about being pastoral is, how is it that we are connected? We talk about being a connectional church, a church who is built on relationship, and things like coaching and caring for our churches, our pastors, and the relationships that we find between all those two things is how we as a presbytery live into helping you all, our churches, be more pastoral in your ministry. And then there is prophetic. Well, we get the prophets from the Old Testament. The prophets' jobs were not to call out some future that the people might live into, but to remind them of their calling that they had from God, the calling that God placed on them to be a thriving, loving, joyful community. That is the prophet's voice and role, to remind the people who it is God has actually called them to be. So for us, what God has called us to be is one community. So things like confronting racism, doing evangelism in our communities are not new things. They are things that God has hoped for the world and for all of us from the very beginning. The presbytery takes on these three words in hopes that this can be something that we live into in a relationship to how we engage with you, our churches. So our mission as the presbytery is to empower all of you to go out and to actually be the church in the world. We hope that these three things, missional, pastoral, and prophetic, can help our churches do one thing: grow. And not just growth in terms of numbers, but grow in terms of health and thriving and doing good work in your context. Your branches reach out farther, your roots reach in deeper as we grow together. And remember, together, we are making a difference.
All right, so for those who might have just jumped in, that was our general presbyter, John Molina Moore, who's sharing about the presbytery vision these last 5 years. And so that vision, I guess, ended in 2022 technically, but it's the real vision of the presbytery for all of us churches within the presbytery was this missional, pastoral, prophetic kind of guideline. So mission is right there at the forefront of what our presbytery has really focused on and what we as a church have also focused on. And so here's some more information on why mission as we get to thinking about mission at PPC. So for more than 200 years, U.S. Presbyterians have responded to the call of Jesus Christ by proclaiming and living out our faith, laboring with love and energy to promote God's justice in the world. So that comes from the Presbytery Mission Agency, which is a national, and they do international work as well. So it's the whole mission agency of the Presbytery says that Presbyterians have been doing this for 200 years. And where does this call to do mission come from? None other than Jesus himself. And so a reminder that Jesus is ultimately the one who calls us into mission. And so there's many Bible verses we could choose from where we hear and see mission at the forefront. So I chose one from John 17, as you have sent me into the world, so I have sent them into the world. So Jesus calling us as disciples, as Jesus's followers, to go out into the world, to be Jesus's hands and feet to those who so desperately need it. In our church motto, you can hear kind of a missional element to it. So caring for all with faith, hope, and love. And so if you're caring for others, then you're kind of doing mission is another way to think about it. And so it pops up there. And our church mission statement, we're an active Christian community devoted to worship that stirs the soul, education that engages the mind, and service that sends us into the world. And so this was adopted many years ago here at the church, but that missional focus. And so often the pillars of the church mission is one of them, and one of the chief among them. And so there's one of the best Bible stories, I think, that kind of captures the missional mindset is the parable of the sheep and the goats, which ends with, "Truly, I tell you, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did for me." And so I found a video, which is one of my favorite videos and retelling of this. It comes from Godspell, the movie, which was 1973, which was shocking when I saw it when that came out. But it beautifully kind of shares the story of the sheep and the goats. And it's just a few minutes. So I thought it'd be fun to hear from. So this is Jesus's words from the Bible, but then acted out in Godspell.
"Now, when the Son of Man comes in all his glory, with all his angels with him, he will sit in state upon his throne with all the nations gathered before him. And then he will separate the men into two groups, as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And then he'll put the sheep on his right and the goats on his left. Over there. Sheep on his right."
"Oh, the sheep on his right. Oh, I see. Thank you."
"And then he will say to those on his right, sheep, you have my father's blessing.
Oh, wonderful.
Come and enter the kingdom that has been ready since the world was made. For when I was hungry, you gave me food. When I was thirsty, you gave me drink.
That's nothing.
When I was naked and without a home, you took me to your house. And when I was ill and in prison, you came to my aid. Ah, sorry, no goats.
Baloney.
And then they will say to him,
oh, master, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you drink?
Yeah, or in prison and helped you.
And he will say to them, anything you did for one of your brothers, however humble, you did for me.
Oh, I get it.
And he will say to them,
a curse is upon you.
Then they will say to him,
big boy, if we'd have known it was you, we would have taken you around the corner for a cup of coffee.
And he will say to them, anything you did not do for one of your brothers, however humble, you did not do for me. And then they will take their place in eternal punishment. But the righteous shall have eternal life. Come on!
Thank you. All right, so just a reminder that mission is one of the chief things that Jesus teaches in our Bibles and in our scripture and in our faith. And so important to remember it. Hello to everyone that's joined us on the call as well, John and Marcia. And yeah, glad you all are with us as well. All right, so let's get discussing about what mission has looked like here at the church. And so how have you participated in mission at PPC? So one way we could do this is what's been one of your favorite memories of mission, or how have you been actively involved or seen our church involved in mission? What would be some responses? Either programs or events that we did that were very meaningful or impactful over the years.
We had very active community projects,
mm-hmm.
Sometimes aligned with Habitat for Humanity.
Yep.
And we'd go out Saturdays, regardless of the weather, and help build houses, paint houses, paint shelters, clean up homes that were barely livable,
mm-hmm.
and that went on for years. We spent time at the parsonage cleaning up that, putting up new walls, and remember they insulated the basement and trimmed the trees. We did a lot of work there.
Mm-hmm. I do. Those Habitat building houses was always fulfilling.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Was that multiple times in the year, or how often was the church doing Habitat for Humanity?
On Saturdays, we would go out Saturday mornings, and mm-hmm. it was not just us, it was multiple churches across the
nice.
Area.
Yeah. But it would be several
several times a year.
So,
yeah. Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
And then we help Interfaith to select the clothes for at Rockville.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so yep. we involve in helping in the community as well.
Yep, absolutely. So Interfaith Works, the clothing center. And so we're planning to do another clothing sort this year, if not one, multiple times. So yeah, absolutely. So that's been a meaningful program. Mm-hmm. Susan, what were you going to say?
What is the homeless shelter where we serve meals? It's off of
the women's shelter, Interfaith Works. Yeah.
It started out Wilkins Avenue, that's women's right. shelter, and then they transitioned. But
yeah.
But we started it here. I remember they used to come and sleep here.
Yeah.
Their roles, and they would go out. They could leave their things here, but they would have to go out into the community looking for a job on some kind of program. Mm-hmm. And we did that for a number of years until the Wilkinson mm-hmm. facility opened up.
Yep.
There was mm-hmm. a snowstorm. Wasn't
there was.
Oh, gosh.
We were here a little longer than we had thought.
Yep, absolutely. So the church even opened up its doors to those who needed it.
And, in the fellowship hall.
Yep, wow. And so now that model shifted to where there's now a center that we recommend when people come or seek.
Yeah. Offer, spending the night at the men's shelter, I remember mm-hmm. doing that
yeah.
all night.
Cooking. Yeah, Bob did too.
Yeah, and mm-hmm. you know, being on call, it didn't matter if it, and fixing breakfast. I think we did something like that.
Well, we did a mm-hmm. holiday dinner and invited the needy to come in and at Christmas and had the same meal that we would eat ourselves mm-hmm. and to provide for them.
Yeah, very nice. Mm-hmm.
For me, I think it was the mission trips, with the youth, mm-hmm. and then the intergenerational ones, especially the ones to New Orleans, and when we went to Florida.
Nice.
Those mm-hmm. have been really important to me.
Yeah, absolutely. So mission trips, yeah, that seems to be one of the big, yeah.
Yeah, I think just to pick up on Ed's point, the holiday dinner that we used to have, we would invite folks. Often they were folks that would get the giant food cards that mm-hmm. we had and come to the church. Mm-hmm. And I thought that was very meaningful because we were bringing people from the outside mm-hmm. that were in need, et cetera, in. And then we shared some fellowship during that dinner and try to go out of our way to eat with them, talk with them, et cetera. The other thing that I recall at that time, which I thought was very good, again, this was a number of years ago, but I remember Sean at that time, instead of handing out the gift cards, which was typically our practice previously,
mm-hmm.
he wanted to talk to each one of them when they came briefly. And he ended up conducting a Bible session. Mm-hmm. I forget if it was every once a week. I mean, I think it may have been once a week in the parlor where they would come. And I recall too at some of our worship services, you know, maybe one or two of these folks might show up. I mean, they weren't dressed in suits and so on, but they were welcomed by the congregation. Mm-hmm. And they thought so much of our pastor at that time, based upon the Bible study and the conversations he was having with him. So I kind of remember that as quite a memorable outreach. It connects to the, you know, the holiday supper that we had where we invited all of these folks, basically, or their friends to come pretty much wide open.
Yeah.
And we sent them home with leftovers.
Yeah. So it seems like we used to use our church or use the church space as a way to gather people or yeah. as a missional outreach. Mm-hmm. And so that shifted that model a little bit based on what these other shelters that have opened up and can do more than our maybe church community could in terms of getting people the help they need and jobs and that kind of thing. And so so then the church began supporting the Interfaith Works Women's Shelter, doing meals at least one week out of the year, right? And for many number of years, and so many different ways. Anyone on our Zoom call, are there any memories of mission at PPC that stand out to you that you'd want to share? And hello, Julie, as well. Glad you're joining us. Oh, Marcia, you're muted. If you want to unmute first, we'd love to hear.
While she's unmuting, I think John Soule put in the chat the mission trip.
Oh, got
so
it.
So yeah. It's about the same time that somebody in person mentioned that. He added that to the chat.
Yeah, absolutely. Perfect. The mission trip, work camps. And then Vicky said the Project Shine, which I know is a big undertaking by the community as well, supporting one family, was it? Or maybe two?
Couple families.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. Marcia, what about you?
Yes, it was the trip to New Orleans. Nice. Which was really a wonderful experience. And Sonia made all the breakfasts, as I recall, which was quite an undertaking. And I think we called it Christmas in April, when we would go to a designated home and help them clean up all the things that I think Tom mentioned, inside and outside. That was an annual event, at least for me, which I enjoyed very much. And of course, as Beatrice said, the sorting of the clothes and interfaith and the meals for the women's shelter, just such a variety of things. And I remember Mary Reichley for years was head of the week that we housed the homeless in the church, and she would get up and make a hysterically funny announcement encouraging people to sign up to help, which they did.
Nice. That's awesome. Thank you, Marcia, for sharing. Absolutely. So lots of wonderful ways our church has done mission in the past. And so I wanted to highlight for us a few ways that we often will talk about doing mission or being the church. And so one of the models that you'll often hear in church is time, talents, and treasure. And so when it comes to mission, we can give our time. And so one example of this would be mission trips, so youth and adult trips that have historically happened here in the church, or service, so clothing sort, apartment setup, outdoor cleanups, et cetera. So you can give of your time when it comes to mission. Another way is talent, so sharing one's expertise. And I think a great example of this is Tom Haugen and Poor Christo, so sharing your medical expertise with the organization and helping those in Ecuador. Hello, come on in. Sharing our talent. So many of us are in different all kinds of different professions. Some of us are great communicators and can share that with different organizations. And so we can use our talents. And then the final way is our treasure. And so donation drives. So right now we have a Manna Food Center. We just did a Leveling the Playing Field collection. We do a backpack collection each year. We've done coat collections in the past, apartment setup. So all kinds of ways to share our treasures. And there's also special collections. And so a few times a year, there's different Presbytery special collections, as well as we'll sometimes offer collections for either hurricane relief or different things that pop up or refugees or all kinds of different things. And so this is one model that we've used and continue to use to think about how we can be a missional church. And so one of the ways that our mission committee team in particular has framed this and what mission look like is a focus on local, national, and international organizations. And so I kind of broke them up here, except the order is a little different because I took it from our website. So locals in the middle, nationals kind of that top portion. And then at the bottom, we can see some international groups that we work with. And so this model is one that since I've come to the church, we've kind of focused on as a mission committee. And it's a good model, but we're actually moving to a new one that I'll share with everyone that focuses more on areas of support and less on this distinction between local, national, and international, because often different groups will do national initiatives or local initiatives or both. And so it's hard to kind of just use this as categories, but it's been helpful to see that we do a lot through our presbytery. We support a lot of local organizations, as you can see in the middle there, which is maybe more of most of our emphasis, which is part of being in a community and trying to give back to the community. And then you can see a few international organizations that we're involved with as well. And so Hands Along the Nile is the Egyptian group that helps support women in particular who need help and need a job. And so it helps them get started and kind of gives out loans and then supports people in their area. Por Cristo does amazing medical work in Ecuador. And then that's our missionaries in Malawi, this bottom right signal, which is the Africa Presbytery logo. And so the present, we're kind of shifting gears a little bit in our mission committee team under Julie's leadership last year and then Tracy's this year, Tracy Talbot, Julie McMahon. And so we're really emphasizing relationship building when it comes to mission. And so in the past, we supported a great number of organizations, and there's a great number of organizations that are worth supporting and do God's work and are incredible, but we're really focusing on how can we build relationships with the communities that we are supporting. And so part of that has been kind of narrowing down which groups we support. And so one example of this is Nourish Now and Mana Food. So both of them help with food insecurity in our county. But they're doing the same thing, and there's actually a coalition of food networks in our county. And so if one group has excess food, they give it to the other organization that helps other families. And so it's all kind of like the food groups or the food organizations in our area are all supporting one another. And so one of the things we've done this past year is really focused on Mana Food. And so you'll see the Mana Food collection down there. And so in doing that, we're able to have more opportunities to partner with Mana Food than if we were to spread it out over Nourish Now and Mana Food. And so they're both great organizations, both worth supporting. We're really thinking of how can we build relationships. And so we've gotten to know the CEO and some of their volunteers even more at Mana Food through this, through kind of narrowing down our focus and our lens as the mission committee. So that's just one example, but that's what's happening kind of across the board. And so this year in particular, we have two big initiatives that you might have heard about. And so first is we are becoming an Earth Care congregation. And so what that means is our session has voted and approved us to focus on environmental care as part of our kind of all church programming and mission outreach in general. And so what that entails is we have done kind of an audit of our own church community and our own church building, which includes everything from our education to our mission to our building itself to our parking lot. And so we've looked at everything that we have going, and we have enough points to enter into this initiative, the Earth Care Congregation. And so that's one big initiative that we're undertaking this year, and we're going to look for more opportunities of how we can take care of the earth that God has made and that desperately needs care. And so we're looking forward to that. And I have a video right after this that'll share a bit more about that. And we're also this year thinking about the 60th celebration of our church. And so our church community turns 60 this year, which is very exciting. And so there's all kinds of ways that our church has done mission in the community. And so it's going to be a fun year of thinking about how we can share those joys, share those wins with the community, and think about where we're headed in the future, continuing in that line of mission work. And so I do want you to know present, there's a mission initiative tomorrow. We have a few slots left. I think we have about 7 slots left. If you want to help out with our MLK Junior Day of Service, we're going to go to Leveling the Playing Field, which is an organization that collects sporting equipment. We're going to help sort their warehouse. And so we have, I think, 25 initials. So we have about 18 people signed up right now. And so if anyone's interested in coming, there's a few spots left. You can touch base with me and I can help you get signed up for that project, which is taking place tomorrow. But let's talk a little bit more about what this Earth Care network, what this Earth Care congregation means. And so here's a video that kind of launched this program.
Well, the Earth Care Network came about, I think, after the Power to Change report that was produced by General Assembly in 2007.
And it calls for us to strive for a zero carbon footprint.
The Earth Care Network consists of the congregations in the National Capital Presbytery that are certified by the PCUSA Earth Care Certification Program.
Rockville United Church has participated in the Earth Care Network for the past 3 years, and we just submitted our fourth year's certification application for Earth Care certification. You can get connected to the network by going to the Presbytery's website. Look for us under Missions, and there's a link to our Yahoo Groups page. One of the things that we do when we get together is share our stories, help each other with ideas about how we can improve our individual churches. The Earth Care Network also has this Power to Change grant.
The grants are for about $2,000 each, and it's a matching grant. And the grant must be applied towards reducing energy consumption, setting up an educational program, or perhaps to establish an advocacy program.
And we at Warner Memorial have received two grants. The first one was for an energy audit.
As a result of our energy audit, one of the investments we decided to make in our church was new energy efficient windows throughout the facility. We had single pane windows, and now we have new energy efficient double pane windows with argon gas that also block the heat in the summer. So this will help make our building much more comfortable and energy efficient.
The Presbytery's Mission Coordinating Committee has been very instrumental in funding the Power to Change grant program.
We've given away 14 different grants to all kinds of churches within the Presbytery.
We anticipate that more and more congregations will become more aware of Earth Care priorities and will increase their consciousness about the need to reduce their carbon footprint.
Together.
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 We are making a difference.
All right, so that's one of the, and so the program has grown since this video came out back in 2017, but we're basically joining this, so we're trying to become an Earth Care congregation, and it means really focusing on our environmental impact, both as a community here at the church and with our actual church building and all of us as members. So we're going to have different ways to educate ourselves on how to reduce our carbon footprint. And there's kind of a tangible piece to this too, because when you have double pane windows, when you have better HVAC systems, you actually do save in the long term on costs. And so it's kind of a short-term investment that has long-term benefits for the church community. And so one of the big projects that our property community is looking at right now is replacing a lot of our HVAC systems, because they were original with the church when it was built. And so they're quite old at this point. Almost all of them are, I think just two or three units have been updated in the 2000s. And so, so that's one area where our community is maybe spending more than we have to, and it's be a large upfront cost, but then long-term we would end up saving. And so as we're living more as an Earth Care congregation, it has financial benefits as well as spiritual benefits. And so we're looking to share that this year and moving forward as we continue as an Earth Care congregation. So if you're interested in that or passionate about the environment and want to join our Earth Care team, we're going to gather next month, I believe, for the first time. And so you'd be welcome to be part of that committee that's forming under John Soule and Julie McMahon. All right, perfect. So let's look at some of the organizations that we have supported in this past year as we're still thinking about the present. And so this is kind of the new way that Mission is thinking about our breakdown of who we support and how we are being God's hands and feet in the world. And so instead of just focusing on that local, national, international, which we still have, and we're still active in all three of those areas, we're trying to think of what are the kind of the big missional areas that we should be or could be helping with in our community and in our world. And so we've kind of broken it out into these categories, which obviously aren't perfect, but they help us just glimpse at who we're supporting and how we're being God's hands and feet. So food insecurity, education, refugee immigrant support, housing and social support, spreading the gospel, health and wellness, environment, special projects, and then kind of a wide reaching broad category of just kind of many different organizations that are aided by one organization. So obviously it's not perfect, because Kind Works does environmental work as well as different special projects throughout the year, but it kind of helps us break down how are we helping with food insecurity in our county. And so we have an answer, Manna Food. That's the organization we work with. We collect food each week here at the church, and we do different projects with them throughout the year. How are we supporting education? Well, Kind Works has some great education programs that help others, and Solutions Hometown Connection helps with refugees. And so that's kind of our go-to organization. And so if we have members come in and say, I'm really passionate about housing and social support, how can I get plugged in the community? We have kind of an organization that our mission committee has paired with, we've done projects with, and can help plug in. And so many of our members are active with one or many of these organizations right now, which is awesome. And so we can kind of see there's a wide range, a wide reach of projects that we're involved with that help to do God's work and help people in our community. And so I'm sure some of us or many of us in this room have had some touch points with organizations that we see up here, but this is kind of a new way we're trying to think about and approach mission this year. And so so just wanted to share that. Are there any questions or thoughts as we look at this kind of new model? Yeah.
I noticed that spreading the gospel mm-hmm. is just one of many.
Yeah.
Not sure that's correct.
I thought
we're here to spread the gospel.
Yeah, absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Some of the social service activities, there are organizations that do it better than we do.
Gotcha. Yeah. So evangelism or spreading the gospel. So yes, I think my sermon today is going to touch on this as well. So I think it's a good point that everything we do should be evangelism or spreading the gospel. So when we're helping with food insecurity, we should be sharing the joy of Christ and love of Christ with others. And so, yes, Del, to your point, everything does. But these are kind of organizations that really specifically focus on that. And so maybe that's why we threw it up as a category. But for instance, I think all of these are great organizations and great ways to spread the gospel. Either it doesn't have to be explicit. It can be just part of all that we're doing as we do mission as well. So, but a good point. So really spreading gospel, I agree, should be part of all of these outreach and organizations. Tom.
For many years, the mission committee has decided two principles. One, to have someone in the church be the lead person to mm-hmm. every charity that we invest in.
Yep.
Secondly, give money to organizations in which our small contribution will have the greatest impact. Mm-hmm. And Julie went through and looked at the budgets of some of these organizations. You know, I read for the World, $20 million. Year organization. Well, our $500 is not going to make much of a bump, but some of the other ones will have an impact. So we pared out a lot of the major philanthropically based organizations. That's why you're not going to see a long list. And you have to have a person in the congregation who's the touch person. They don't have to be a mission committee member. Mm-hmm. They have to be part of it. So we have a direct personal relationship with the whoever is receiving our limited funds.
Yep, absolutely. And that's part of that relationship building. And so really having kind of a touch point and a relationship that's built when we support these different groups. And what that does is it leads to more opportunities. And so with Stephanie Hampton, we through her, we found out about leveling the playing field. We set up a drive. We're helping out tomorrow again. And so there's more kind of that relationship building and multiple, there's kind of more buy-in first from the community. And because when you have someone as that kind of liaison person, and also just you grow in that relationship. So you get to know the people in the organization and yeah, instead of just kind of writing that check and that being the only relationship you have with the organization. And so, yeah, definitely Susan.
Just a very specific question. Yeah. Mm-hmm. The KindWorks, is that a local organization? I'm not aware of that particular.
Yeah, KindWorks. Yeah, it's a local organization. They're semi-new in the area. We worked with them when we did the apartment setup and kind of the month of service back in 2019. And so that was the group we partnered with. And so they've been kind of a great liaison. They do all kinds of things from cooking meals to doing the apartment setups to helping with tutors or education. And so they do kind of all a wide range of things. And really their niche is having a huge volunteer base that helps support other organizations in the area. And so what they're kind of best at is, the Interfaith Works Women's Shelter needs meals for this week. We have volunteers that can fill in that gap. And so that's kind of how I've understood their impact. And let me see, I saw a chat message maybe. Vicky's saying we also, the apartment set up with them. And so they're kind of a local organization. One of the members at Gaithersburg Presbyterian Church is one of the co-CEOs, I believe, Deb, is it Lang? Yeah, so we've worked with them quite a few times in the past and they've been a great kind of liaison group for us. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. So that's one of the newer ones within the last year that we've begun supporting. Yeah, definitely. All right, let's keep moving then. As we look ahead to 2023, and so there's many ways that the Mission Committee has already planned out and are starting to put dates on the calendar for things such as clothing store at Interfaith Works, with Beatrice already alluded to. We have the backpack collection, which we do each summer at the end of August. that goes to students in the area who are in need. We have the possibility of maybe doing for the first time, at least since I've been here, maybe first time in a while, first aid CPR training for the congregation. And so anyone who would want to be part of that would be welcome. Manna food collections, Giving Tree tote bags, Middle School Mission Week, and more. And so we have all of these awesome events planned through for this year that we hope that you all will help be involved with or help see to fruition. And so would you like to see any additional projects this year as you look at this list or think about ways that we can be missional in our outreach or organizations that you might know that we have not yet partnered with but could in the future? What would you like to see PPC do in addition to these?
Will we ever involved with Martha's Table or any of the DC? I'm just thinking being in the DC area, reaching out. I think, isn't there a not Western Presbyterian, but there's a Presbyterian church that's more towards Foggy Bottom that we had sort of associated with in years gone by. But I think getting engaged, you know, maybe moving into partnership with the Presbyterian Church in DC.
Not to my knowledge, we haven't been as involved. The one DC kind of organization that we were working with was Young Adult Volunteers, which was through the presbytery, but I think that's different than, was it Martha's Kitchen that you were referencing? And so yeah, maybe DC, so having an outreach or helping programs there, since we're so close, that's a good thought. Yep.
There used to be a time when Kerry Stolpas and Sean had an active ministry at Manor Care for the elderly.
Yeah.
I wonder if any of that is being thought about by the mission committee.
Definitely. Was that part of like the preaching? So you would go and preach there and then interact with
it? Preaching, but also John Hummon came and provided the piano music.
Oh, nice. Okay. Yeah.
And it was quite well organized for a while.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, that was, so I know that was shut down during COVID, but I think they just recently opened that up again for pastors. So that was actually something I was looking into getting involved at. I think I was looking at King Farm, but yeah, so definitely programs like that. And so basically what that would be is like a pastor going in and preaching a sermon that they preached on Sunday. So it's not even that much extra work, but it's being involved in the community and getting to know more people and supporting our congregation that are in those facilities. And so I think that's a great idea and one that I'm actually looking into as well. So it's a good point. And the serve communion, yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And so, yeah, definitely.
Is there one, maybe it's already in here, I just don't know the organization. Is there one that's like more focused on like the foster care system or foster children? Or maybe that's part of like the Giving Tree, I don't know. But
yeah, not that I'm aware of. I don't know, maybe Julie could help me out, but I'm not sure if we've supported foster care. And so that could definitely be an area we look into and one that I know many members would be or are passionate about. And and so, yeah, definitely. I think that's a good one to add to our list and add to our areas of support. Thank you.
One more thing. I'm looking here. There are a lot of collections here, so that we're collecting and then we're giving. But I think as with the mission trips, it's really important to me to think, or going to Mount Care, to think of dealing with the people directly.
Yes.
Exactly. So we have collections, but we also want to interface with those individuals. I think one is the supper that we had. And so I think that's an important component to consider also.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And so maybe pairing, like we did with Leveling the Playing Field, a collection in the fall with a hands-on project in the spring. And so I think that most of the organizations that we have up on here, there's possibilities for that. And so I think that's part of the relationship building. And so it's not that collections are bad, because those items are definitely needed and they go to a great place, but it's how can we kind of take that to the next step and really be hands-on with these mission projects. So absolutely, yeah. And that's one of the things that the mission committee's been working on and seeking to do more of. And so that's where the clothing sort came in and where the Leveling Playing Field. And so yes, hoping to do more of that as we stretch in the future. Yeah. So
there's nothing on here that would exhaust our budget. It's very low cost.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Yeah. So it's not a money thing. It's a time thing, right? As we think of time, talents, and treasure. And so
no treasure.
This is a timing. Yeah.
So that's a good list to have.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Chris, so I got the impression that Mission Committee was trying to streamline.
Yep.
But I'm getting the impression again that it's opening up. So the question is, if they've narrowed down, do they have like two or three, or what's about, will they speak into whatever number you have.
Yeah, definitely. And so part of the trimming down has already happened. And so we had many more groups than this. The last, like 3 years ago, we had maybe almost twice as many groups as this that our church was supporting. And so there's been a bit of a trim down in terms of who we're sending checks to and directly supporting. And so that has mostly already happened. And so like right now, one of the things Mission Committee is thinking about is stepping stones and Rainbow Place. And so seeing if there's energy and support for both of those, or if we might just focus on one and get more involved with them instead of having two that we're supporting. And so so some of that trimming has already happened, and it's not trimming like it's, so they're all great organizations, as I said earlier, but really how can our church community is limited in size. And so we're not an enormous church that has thousands of members that can be hands-on in all these different groups. And so we really hope to have one person as kind of our liaison person that builds this relationship, keeps us up to date on special drives or special needs that the group has throughout the year, special programs that come up. And so So this is kind of a shorter list than we've had in the past, but one that we're continuing to think about and kind of narrow down as well. Tom, did you want to speak to that?
A little historical perspective. 15 years ago, 20 years ago, we had a budget of completion of 120,000, and we had 120,000.
Sorry, just repeating what you said.
Oh, that's okay.
Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah. I'm going to find this committee out.
Yes. Sony would say $111,101, but it's up to $118,000. We had 20 active people on the committee would come to the meetings. 20.
Mm-hmm.
And so we had lots of help, lots of ideas, and a big budget. So now our budget, $35,000 plus endowments of five. So we're a third of the budget we had 15 years ago. So that's made, forced many, many critical decisions of how we're going to spend our money the best way. So just so you people understand where we were and where we are now.
So with that in mind, you said there's like 40 now. I mean, I see, I don't know, like 10 organizations. So does each of them get approximately 4K, or do some get the 500 Chris Luch earlier and some get a much larger?
Yeah, it's
how is it?
Well, as I mentioned, we try to give money to the organization that our contribution make the best.
Sure. Impact. Yeah.
And go the furthest. And,
right.
And then we have, yeah, that's the idea.
Yeah, so it's not kind of blanket. So we don't give the same amount to each organization. Sure. There's different levels, and part of that is kind of discerning from the mission committee, as well as kind of what we've given in the past. And so like some organizations really rely on the couple thousand that we might give versus the 500. I think the one that we've supported the most has been Interfaith Works, maybe in terms of monetary, just because the church has long ties with them. But we're also even thinking about that and maybe seeing if it might go elsewhere, since it is a bigger organization compared to the other. So there's been kind of a lot of discernment there. But I think that's maybe my best answer for us. It's kind of all over the place in terms of how much goes to each group, but a lot of it's like need-based. And so if one organization really needs something for 1 year, or if we're supporting like a hurricane disaster, like the Presbyterian Disaster Assistance, or other groups that are kind of like really pressing at times, like at the beginning of COVID, we supported local organizations more. And that was our focus as a mission committee in order to really help families that were struggling in the midst of COVID. And so it all kind of depends on the year and what crises rise. But yeah, good question.
For Mana and Loving Plainfield, both of those I think are very collection heavy that I see. Do we also contribute financially to them, or is it more program?
Yeah, both. Okay. Absolutely. And so really we're trying to have multiple levels of engagement. And so like time, talent, energy. So Loving Plainfield, we did the collection. We gave a donation, and we're doing a hands-on project with them. And so that's like maybe the model we want to aim for with each of these organizations. And we're not fully there with all these organizations, but hoping to live more into that. Julie, did you want to jump in as well? Sorry, let's let Julie jump in.
Yeah, I was just going to say that we kind of, as a philosophy last year, decided that if there was a group we were supporting with a collection or a program or an initiative, we would also financially support that organization. So that we're helping fund their operating costs. So, and then in terms of the, you know, taking the number of categories on the screen and dividing the budget into that, there are a few other groups and specific programs that are not really shown by a logo. For example, the high school and church-wide mission trips, which the financial support usually goes with the organization that we're partnering with that specific year, or maybe the year prior. The year that we went to Florida with the trip, as well as a mission trip, we supported both of those financially in addition to our mission trip program. And I think one logo to get at a DC-based program, but that includes Montgomery County, is the DC Area Diaper Bank that we added just last year for the first time, that included both a program and some financial support to go with that. So, you know, Scotland AME Zion Church is something we just added at the very end of last year. And we will be exploring ways to share that initiative and identify ways that we might be able to help that local group recover from flood damage. So those are just a few other comments I wanted to make as I was listening.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yep. I guess the question I have, and maybe for those who have been, you know, involved in our history and so on, you mentioned time, talent, and treasure. Mm-hmm. And as Tom mentioned, you know, just budget constraints, whatever, our treasure impact has reduced over, you know, the past, whatever, 10 years, 20 years, whatever. However, the time and talent, which are equally important, because that gets to the outreach that we're able to kind of bring, not that we're, you know, giving sermons to people, but the fact that we lead in our relationships in these projects with our heart and compassion, to Dell's point to an extent. Is there a sense that our time and talent has increased or stayed the same? I'm not looking for exact, but just a sense, particularly for those who've been around for a long time on this, is that dimension. So if we got time, talent, and treasure, you could put a ball around that. Okay, the treasure has collapsed a little bit as a result of both budget pressures. Is there a sense that our talent and time has increased? Or where do we, we would like it to increase, I presume, in the future. In terms of our plans, but I'm just not too sure what our history, but it's been more or less the same in the past. I don't know if any folks have an idea on that.
Yeah, that's a great question. So I think in my almost 4 years I've been here at the church, we've really expanded our time. And so we've had many more programs from that first year in 2019, and then COVID kind of threw a loop in everything. But that's now, true. Especially this year again, we're really ramping up our hands-on projects. And so I think that it's been increasing, at least since I've been here, and that focus and emphasis on that I think is important and increasing. And I think that even though our budget has shrunk, I think that that's not to say that our impact has. And so many in our community give above and beyond what the mission committee gives out to these organizations. So we have members that support one or various of these organizations throughout the year at different times. And so our church community impact is bigger than just that mission budget and what it shows, because everyone here and is very generous and gives above and beyond what just our church community does. And so I think that it might have shifted to where more of that happens, and before it was maybe more of the church impact. But so I would say that's still there. And then talents, I think that we continue to have many members who give of their talents to different organizations. And so I think that maybe we've seen a slight increase in the time and maybe the talents as that decrease in treasure, at least from what I'd say, but maybe not. Tom shaking his head.
No. Fewer people are doing more. We should do it the other way around. Get more people involved. You don't have to be a member of the mission committee to do that. The mission committee is trying to recruit people to take on projects for a few months, a few weeks, or one day, instead of having the same people over and over again that some of you know. There's same people step up. So I think the mission committee hasn't marketed the opportunities. And this presentation that you're doing should be more widely spread, so people have, and they can latch on to a project and not be worried about it's another Presbyterian committee. Oh my gosh. Come on. But they say I can do it for a Saturday afternoon twice a year or just all day, one day would make a huge difference. And that spreads and bring their youth into it. And that's what we really need to do. I agree with Bob. The money's not going to be there. So where can we expand the talent and the time, but spread that talent among more people? And we can list how many people have done any mission project in the last 12 months, period. Well, let's see. You know, it would be surprised, because I know we're sitting on the committee. Who's going to do this? Who's going to do that? Got to find people. So that's one of the things we should really promote.
Yeah, Chief.
Yeah, so I was intrigued with the emphasis on partnership. And I think this conversation. Yeah. But I'll preview it by saying, during my time with CDC is an organization that helps with vaccine funds. They had to redefine what partnership meant. You know, who was doing what, and who can do more. I am assuming that, say, when you're partnering with Mana, for example, someone in Mana has that information, you know, or say PPC is bringing this, bringing that, then within PPC can define what it is, you know, is it time, is it money? So the question is, besides having someone in Mana from the committee, is there anything else to describe partnership, you know, metrics or something that is famous?
Yeah, that's a good question. So one thing Tracy's really been helping us do is track more of that engagement and more of that partnership. And so how many people were involved in this project, how many donors were there if we did a special collection, and so keeping track of that. And yeah, I think that's an area in general we're trying to grow as a church, is really, so it's easy to track number of people when it comes to these kind of things, but it's harder to track either impact or number of lives that, or touch points from the full congregation that got involved. And so I think that's a growing question for us, and one that we're trying to learn more and focus more on moving forward, which is how do we really track partnership? What does that mean? I think those are good questions that we're continuing to think on. Yeah, and then we'll keep moving.
Does the mission committee take a look at the percentage of administrative costs of a particular charity to operational costs and actual programming costs? I think in the world of giving, that's turned out to be a fairly serious problem, and someone needs to look at that.
We've done that. Julie did it. There's
just this last year. Yeah,
a website or something. You can every 503, whatever it is.
I will want to see.
Thank you. has to report that. And we dropped some organizations because, one, either their administrative costs are high or their operational budget is huge, which is fine.
Maybe.
And they're also rated. It's like a some kind of rating.
It's a letter rating system.
Yeah.
ABCD,
something like that. So we have looked at it, but it's about time we do that. And Julie is the one who spearheaded that, as I recall.
Yeah, absolutely. One example of that would be the West Virginia group. So there was kind of a parent group that put us in partnership with the church in West Virginia. But this year, the mission committee felt more called to give directly to the church that was doing the work in the community than the kind of parent organization, which a lot of their funding, sadly, this year went into administrative because they had they hired someone and then had to fire them. And that was where all their budget this year went. So we felt more comfortable giving to the community where it would go to the people, if that makes sense. So that's one example of how the mission committee discerned just that. And so something we're looking more into as we move into the future as well. All right. So one of the big things, very exciting things that we're looking to do this year is a summer mission trip. This is typically our youth mission trip, but intergenerational. So everyone's invited if you feel called to be part of it, is our summer mission trip. And so this year, the last 2 years, we went to West Virginia and had a wonderful time there and made amazing connections with the community and with the Church Freedom Full Gospel Assembly of God. So Pastor Cab and Benita. Benita has cancer very sadly, and so they're canceling all of their summer mission trips in groups in order to focus on her recovery. And so that wasn't an option for us this year, and so we're looking elsewhere. And so where we're looking and really feel called is to go to Florida. And so this would be the furthest mission trip, at least since I've been here, that our youth would go on. And so this is a big undertaking for our community. And the why of it is there's so much need in Florida after the recent hurricanes. They're still trying to recover in the panhandle from Hurricane Michael back in 2018. And now Hurricane Ian has come through and ravaged And so we're really looking to give back and help the community there. And so we're trying to find a group to partner with. And so there's many ways that you could help make this happen. So you could come on the trip, which would be incredible, more than welcome to. You could donate miles. We're going to do a pancake fundraiser at the end of the month, which all proceeds will go towards, or all funds will go towards the mission trip in the summer. You could sponsor a student or a leader to go. There's many ways to get involved. And so we're really hoping that the whole church can kind of come together and make this trip happen, because we're going to be flying down, which is an additional cost. And so so it's going to take more, but there's so much need there that we really feel called to make this trip happen this year. And so we're probably not going to go back to Florida every single year, but this is kind of a one-time need that we're feeling called to make happen. So it takes all of us to make this mission trip happen, and we'd love your ideas and support as we more tangibly pull that trip together. All right, here's another video from, this is from our national level presbytery that talks about how the church can move forward thinking about mission. So I thought it was really helpful, which we can end on, and then a few questions after. But thinking about what the church looks like moving forward, especially in regards to mission.
I believe, again, we have to get back to the issues of innovation. We're going to have to do things differently that are related to the context in which we are now living. It means adjustments in churches, in church buildings and church institutions. How do we utilize what we now have in the midst of us? And how do we do it in a way that is broadening the witness of our denomination, but also the witness of Christendom, for people who really have to find the gospel in different places? We're going to have to find other ways by which we are streaming and help making Christendom, in a sense, a lot more accessible. And yet, at the same time, taking many of the rules, if we would call it, out of how we become members and how we get connected and how we find ourselves to a way of repairing the breach. And I think that's the challenge. We have lived in formalities for a very long time. And I think formalities are great. I think it's our good opportunities when we come together, when we know and we have planned a lot of what needs to be done. And I'm not speaking of just running around and trying to create things just for the sake of creating. But I think we now have to be innovative in how we do that. And what does that actually help with the larger context of our society, not just those who come to church on Sunday morning, but how we reach out deeply to individuals who may not yet know the gospel, but they are looking for a lifeline of hope in a time of despair. And they're trying to hold on till the morning comes. But that does not happen without help. And that help has to come from our church institutions. How do we bring people back into the fold who've been left out? How do we go to the greatest resistance to the gospel rather than going to the easy places and dropping food somewhere and walking away? How do we learn to love in this present day and to renew our spirit in caring for individuals, and doing it not counting the cost, but recognizing there is a need. And because we have a faith that stands on meeting those needs, we stop on the side of the road and we somehow or another trust that even if we're late, there's a God who will put us in the right place to witness to the very thing that God intends for us. That's hard work, but that's faith work. That's work that doesn't necessarily dot I's and cross T's, but it's work that sometimes can be messy. And sometimes it's work that basically says to us, just go. That's the command, nothing else. Just go. And when you get there, you'll know that there is an unseen friend that will meet you there. I think we have to be more faithful in these days, and we have to rely upon our faith, and we have to begin to take a daring witness to transforming the world that we're in. And I think that then changes the society. That then changes individual values. That then changes the kinds of stupors that people find themselves in day by day, being able to see something, just like they saw the power of Jesus. We have to now reflect that more than ever before.
All right, thought that was a helpful kind of challenge for us as a church in how we can be missional. And so future possibilities that the mission committee is thinking of are international trips. And so Hands Along the Nile, which is the group that Alex Shalaby is CEO of, right, or chair of, they do kind of trips to Egypt where you kind of get to know a Presbyterian community there and see what being a Christian in minority, because it's not a majority Christian country, and seeing the pyramids and things as well, but it's really that connectional missional trip. So that's a possibility. We could bring back our adult and college mission trips. Last one was in 2020 in January when we went down to Florida. We can use our church space in new ways. We could look at doing a community garden or doing a mission pantry or having programs run out of the church once again. And so lots of possibilities moving forward. And so we're at the end of our time. So we're going to wrap up there. But three questions we can keep in our back pocket as we think about mission. Where would you like to see PPC mission go? How might we partner with and or serve the elementary school right next to us? And what areas would you like mission to address moving forward? We talked a bit about that in the class. And so we're going to end there. Thank you all so much for joining us this morning and thinking about mission and how we can continue to expand and find new ways that God's calling us to be the church and be God's hands and feet in our community. So we're going to end it there and head into worship. So thank you all so much for joining.
Thank you.
Thank you all for joining online. Blessings.